ask about, you know, what is communism? And what, I remember as a 9 year old, they said, there are people who come in the middle of the night, stuff you into, you and your family into a cattle car and ship you to Siberia, which was kind of an interesting response.
Good local time, everyone, and welcome to this new episode of Innovative Minds with Audrey Tong. I feel privileged today to spend time with an important figure from Europe who has long been a political architect of unity in his continent, former Estonian President Toomas Hendrik Ilves. Good time, everyone, and welcome to this new episode of Innovative Minds with Audrey Tong. As Russia's illegal and unprovoked invasion of Ukraine impacts regional peace and prosperity, I feel very privileged today to spend time with an important political figure from Europe who has long been an architect of unity in his continent. Let's welcome former Estonian President Toomas Hendrik Ilves.
Hello.
Hi. President Ilves, let's start with one of your quotes. In January 2021, you tweeted, and I quote, "For the first 34 years of my life, anyone who said my country, Estonia, would ever be free again was considered a nut job. We have been independent again for 30 years, a member of the EU and NATO, and one of the most digitally advanced countries in the world," end of quote. A year on, and we're seeing that the people of Ukraine fighting for their freedom and the people of Taiwan taking great hope in this courageous example. So what message does the example of Estonia, Ukraine, and Taiwan send to those under the yoke of authoritarianism?
Well, for me, it was a belief that one day, back then, 34 years ago, that one day we would be independent. And a secondary belief that given a chance to be free, that the people of my country would accomplish great things. And that is what we did.
Yeah, lo and behold. and you're known as the former president of Estonia, and you were a member of the European Parliament. But before that, you've also worked in various professions before your career as a politician. So please tell us about your past jobs and how that influenced your ideas about freedom and the world.
Well, most influential, I think, for my ideas was actually reading a lot about the issue of freedom.
As a child of refugees, I was always sort of concerned about why it was that I was living in the United States when my parents were Estonian and we spoke Estonian at home. And how did we get there and why did we get there? And then that led me to ask about, what is communism? And what, I remember as a 9 year old, I said, "Dad, what are communists?" And he said, "There are people who come in the middle of the night, stuff you into, you and your family into a cattle car and ship you to Siberia," which was kind of an interesting response I was not waiting for. But nonetheless, then I started looking at all of this and why things were the way they are. And I read a lot of, I read John Locke and Jefferson and, that influenced me. And later on, I went to work for Radio Free Europe in 1984 because they asked me to, but also because I thought that was one of the things that was genuinely necessary for
people in my country was to hear objective news, I mean, uncolored by propaganda. And so that kind of stuck with me. It stuck with me to the point where in 1986, I remember the director of Radio Free Europe said, and this was also the inspiration for that quote that you had, was he said, "Oh, Thomas, you know, you write so well. I mean, but, you know, Estonia will never be independent. And we'd like to train you on something that has a much bigger future than Estonia." Well, it was just when I was asked if I wanted to go. I'll back up. The director of Radio Free Europe called me into his office and told me, said, "Well, we really like your analyses and you write well. But, you know, Estonia will never be independent, so we want you to work on something bigger and has a bigger future." And I said, "Well, what's that?" He said, "Terrorism. We want you to become an expert on terrorism, and we'll, you know, take off from work for a year or two, and we'll make a terrorism expert out of that." Now, in terms of, you know, career choices, I guess he was very prescient. But on the other hand, at that time, I already thought that, no, I was not going to do that. And instead, I would remain dealing with Estonia, convinced that this would all happen.
I see.
Later on, I mean, the digital part came, and if you want to ask about that, I mean, that came later, right after Estonia regained its independence. And my background was that I had learned to code or program as a 15-year-old. One-off school program that was my math teacher had when she was doing her PhD in math education at Columbia Teachers College. And she wanted to see if she could teach kids the program. So she rented a teletype and a big telephone modem, this big, you stick the phone in, connect it to a mainframe about 30 kilometers away. Mm-hmm. And we learned to program in BASIC. Baby Fortran. At that time in 1971, I guess it was only about a year and a half old, but we learned that, and that was kind of fun. And I remember writing a program to graph y equals x squared, and I forgot to put an n to the program, I remember, and then it plotted out this parabola. And I said, "Wow, it did that." And I just, all I had to do was write a program for it, except then I had to stop the computer because I forgot to put end on it. Nonetheless, that was kind of a transformative experience. And from there on in, I've always been, on the one hand, thought that you could do immense things digitally. And this is, I'm a 15-year-old at the time, in 1970, 71. And on the other hand, I'd never been afraid of it. So later on, when I was in university, I saw an ad. So I programmed a PDP-8, which was called a PDP-8 because it had only 8K of memory, which meant that I had to use a rather low-level language, assembler, which was just, it's hexadecimal, and it's just a matter of 16 characters, 1, 2, 3, 0 through 9, and A through G, and those are all my options. And so I learned to code like that, mm-hmm. which made me even less afraid of things that had to do with digitization. Mm-hmm. So that was, from there on in, I just never really thought much about it. It was just part of life. It came back in 1993, the democracy. We had a new constitution, new fresh elections. And so there were all kinds of debates on which way to go. The crucial thing that for me that made it all rather depressing was that in 1938, which was the last full year before World War II, Estonia and our cousins to the north, Finland, had a GDP per capita where Estonia was slightly better than Finland's GDP per capita. When Estonia, in 1992, the first full year of independence, Estonia had, or let's put it this way, Finland's GDP per capita was eight times, not 8%, eight times the GDP of my country per capita, which shows you how much, shows you the wonders of communism, right? I mean, they advanced year by year. We didn't, we just were stuck there. And so our GDP at the time was $2,800, which is abysmal, per capita, right? And so that looked very hopeless, and especially hopeless was kind of the Zeno's paradox, where Hercules runs after, or Achilles, whoever, Achilles, I guess, runs after the turtle. He never catches up. And I said, well, this is the problem of development. I mean, no matter what we did, we still wouldn't catch up with the people ahead of us because they would be moving as well. So it looked all very bleak. But then in 1993, in the summer, Mosaic came out. And Mosaic was the first web browser. Up till then, I mean, okay, the hypertext transfer protocol was invented by Tim Berners-Lee in 1989, but you really didn't have access to anything. It was, but then the web browser came out, and you had to go to a store and buy it for like $29.95, and you got seven floppy disks that you uploaded. And then mirabile dictu, there was a web browser. I looked at this and I said, wow, this is something where Estonia, despite all of the lack of development in the under 50 years of occupation, we were not behind. And so that if there's one area that we can focus on to catch up, or is even maybe even surpass the West, because we're all starting out at the same point, then it would be digitization. And then the next question was, well, what do you do? And so, and this is where my early sort of experience learning to code came in. I said, well, I mean, people learn, if you can learn to code, even, I mean, which is already a fairly sophisticated thing, as a teenager in high school, why don't we make sure that everybody has access to this? And so then I proposed that we put computers in all Estonian schools, and that we connect them all, which then, because I had an ally in the government, the Minister of Education, who supported the idea, we enacted in 1996. And by 1998, basically all Estonian schools were on, had computer labs and were online. Now, again, these things take a while to have an effect. But by 2016, when we already had several unicorns, I would go around to startups and I'd ask, you know, these guys or girls, I mean, men and women. So how'd you get into this? And basically most of the time they said, oh, I was a child in your program. And I said, oh, okay. So that's certainly one of the lessons, is get people to start early and so to feel comfortable with digital matters. Which had been my experience, but I was kind of just, I mean, when I had that experience, there wasn't much of an opportunity to do anything. Now everyone can do it, whatever they want. So anyway, that was the beginning of kind of Estonia's road towards digitization. Later on, not that much later on, but by the late 90s, we realized that if we're going to be serious about digitization, we would have to develop a far more robust and secure system than the usual email address plus password, which just is not worth a damn thing. I mean, every time I go into Amazon to buy a book, I use that system, but then always go, oh God, what might happen? But so we initiated a really robust, strong system based on everyone getting a unique, secure identity with end-to-end encryption and two-factor authentication, and then a distributed data exchange layer so that we didn't have a single database, but they were all over the place, which also does wonders for security, even though it had more to do with lack of money for us at the time. Mm-hmm. And later on, I guess the third pillar of what we do is data integrity, which, in Europe, everyone is obsessed with privacy. I think privacy is a minor matter, actually, compared to data integrity, because I may not like it if someone publishes my blood type or my bank account, but far worse is if someone changes the record of my blood type or changes my bank account. So that's data integrity versus privacy. And the integrity moment is something that too little has been paid attention to. Actually, really only became an issue with supply chain security during COVID.
Before joining the cabinet, was in social text with the founder, Rose Mayfield, and he used to talk about the earlier days of Estonia, where, as I understand, he was an advisor, and the kind of sense of possibility, but also imminent risk in those earlier days.
Well, there was the digital risk, cyber risk, but there was also political risk in mm-hmm. that while everyone now has... sort of everyone accepts digitization. In the 1990s, there were a lot of sort of Luddite people who thought it was absurd and ridiculous. And when I was in the year after I proposed this, well, basically the teachers' union had a newspaper, and every week, it was a weekly, every week there would be an op-ed or an editorial or some article saying what an idiot I was, how I was going to destroy education, that this was utterly ridiculous. The dumbest idea that Estonia had pursued since independence. And the teachers, of course, were opposed. It makes sense. I mean, because if you're they knew very well that if you're a teacher and you have no clue about digitization, some kid is going to come in there to a computer lab and they're going to just whiz right through everything and you're not going to understand. So there was a lot of opposition from teachers and then kind of that people who were associated with education. Mm-hmm. But it ended after a while. It just kind of died out.
Taiwan only got a political moment to roll out all the students' use laptop program this year, precisely because of the teachers are now more comfortable after the couple years of pandemic. Of course, we never had a lockdown, so it has to be by choice. Like the teachers have to actually think that hybrid is better in order to adopt this kind of teaching method. So I understand the kind of pushbacks. But there's also outside political risks, right? I remember when you visited in 2018, I learned from you that you had a survey in Luxembourg in the beginning and then later on other places to keep all critical national data. And it's particularly necessarily now in Taiwan, we've had a lot of discussion around this topic in light of Russia's invasion of Ukraine. And since we're one of the more seismically active areas, how would you suggest that we tackle this issue of resilience from both natural and unnatural disasters?
Well, I mean, you have both. We don't have the seismic, but well, it actually came out of the experience of Fukushima. where, I don't know, be it the meltdown or the tsunami, one way or another, Japan lost some part of its national data. I don't know much, but anyway, some national data was lost, which got us worried. And so we had been doing regularly copying critical data on a series of CD-ROMs that we would then physically transport to embassies, one or two embassies. So we would always have it within the, I mean, up to date to the last month, say. But then we said, well, actually, if you apply the Vienna Convention on diplomatic immunity and inviolability of embassies, I mean, I don't know what the technical name is, but basically we approached Luxembourg and said, well, how about if we declare a server to be our embassy? So it is, I mean, it cannot be entered. It is completely separate. It is Estonian territory. In Ukraine, we just don't have an ambassador there, but we have a server. That's our embassy. And then we have a 24/7 dedicated line, encrypted, all of that. All the security is taken care of. So all changes in critical data, which include health records, the population registry, property records, are whenever anything is entered in the country, it is entered simultaneously in Luxembourg. So we have all those records. And so we figure, well, I mean, for us, the big issue is security, non-seismic security. I mean, we basically, for the past 1,000 years, Estonia has been invaded on an average of twice a century. So we live in a bad neighborhood. Everyone wants that little piece of territory.
I can understand that feeling, yeah.
So when you're living like that, you figure, all right, let's keep all our data somewhere else as well.
So it's not a code storage like a CD-ROM. It's actually an active backup, which could be switched at any given time. Did I hear you correctly?
Yes. I mean, if we're invaded, then whatever, at the moment things stop, then everything will remain in that server for future use.
Well, then that's probably, I'm very interested because you say this as if it's the most normal thing in the world. However, if we introduce this kind of measures in Taiwan, for example, there will be a lot of political conversations about not just the cybersecurity front of what if they violated conventions and confiscated the servers, the technical front, but also how do you choose that sort of locations? What's the kind of diplomatic protocol of doing so? As you're an expert in this, is there a protocol or is there a evaluation criteria or a kind of multilateral accord or anything that affects the choice of locations?
Well, as I said, it's an agreement between two countries on application of the Vienna Agreement on extraterritoriality and diplomatic immunity, except which always about physical embassies. So, I mean, you cannot enter an embassy of a foreign country.
Or search it or anything, yeah.
Right. Yeah. I mean, well, we just said, we proposed that how about if we do this with a big server? And the government of Luxembourg said, why not?
Okay. So I guess that's very innovative, and that's certainly one innovation that we can take as an example. The other innovation that I became very aware of early on, I think it was in 2014, a lot of my friends applied for the e-residency program, and it attracted people from around the world, including former Japanese Prime Minister Abe Shinzo and many of my friends in Silicon Valley. So do you have a kind of easy-to-explain version of what is the e-residency and how did you envision that to work?
Well, it really touches upon the right of establishment for companies, and which also requires opening a bank account. Mm-hmm. Now, those things, I mean, in a digital era, when you can have a secure digital identity, mm-hmm. You've solved the problem why those things used to be only country-based, because mm-hmm. Because opening a company was open only to residents, mm-hmm. because the country could only verify your identity for those people living on the territory. Mm-hmm. But once you get to, once you can have a digital identity, we can verify you. We do all the know your customer backup. I mean, we take your fingerprints, mm-hmm. and we mm-hmm. have, photographs and your passport mm-hmm. copy. I mean, so we know who you are. Mm-hmm. And if we know who you are, why should we limit the access, your ability to start a company and open a bank account? I mean, mm-hmm. it's basically all you get out of this. Mm-hmm. But that's for companies, that's what matters, is that, and this especially matters within the European Union. I mean, if it were just Estonia, so you can run a business in Estonia. So what? On the other hand, since Estonia is in the European Union, if you establish a company in Estonia, you are established in the EU, which means all kinds of things then mm-hmm. basically apply to you or don't apply. I mean, so if your company... we take the case of Brexit, when we saw a huge upsurge in e-residency, because small businesses, especially that had been, they were established within the EU, in the UK, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. and suddenly they were disestablished within the EU, which meant in terms of tariffs and so forth, a huge disadvantage, and an advantage they lost. So a small business that used to sell things as an EU company, say Germany, suddenly mm-hmm. had problems. But now we offer people the ability to, from outside the European Union, I mean, the people inside the European Union do this because they think it's cute, maybe it's convenient. I know someone opened a company in Estonia simply because they wanted to see how it worked, you know. So, and of course, you do pay your taxes in Estonia, which is also a benefit, though we have a very favorable business tax or corporate income tax. But in any case, it's most effective for people from countries outside the European Union who want to have an EU presence. I don't know, I guess we're getting up there almost to 100,000 these mm-hmm. days. That's for a small country. I mean, it's already a measurable portion of our population. It is important to note it doesn't give you the right to social services, doesn't give you a right to immigrate. All it does is allows you to establish a company in Estonia. Mm-hmm.
Right. So it seems that the innovation here is that it decouples the traditional immigration process, where you have to be within the territory of a country right. in order to be authenticated. And now you're saying basically any of your embassies, which could be a server, could authenticate anyone on Earth, even if they have not visited Estonia and do not plan to visit Estonia, but nevertheless want to do business in Europe.
Precisely. Yes. We see a number of things that, I mean, that's actually, I would say, one of the more minor aspects of
the paper world mm-hmm. that has changed. I think far more interesting than more broadly mm-hmm. is that in the digital era, a far more important aspect of this is that digitization allows us to accomplish amazing things, largely because we're no longer constrained by bureaucracy as a serial or sequential process. Ever since we've had bureaucracy, I mean, if we go back and look at the history of bureaucracy, it probably developed because once you had some kind of political organization, you had people who were warriors full time. So you had division of labor, but some people had to, you know, grow the food that the warriors would eat and also for themselves. And once you had that, you needed a bureaucracy to actually count how much wheat or rice or whatever it is that you mm-hmm. that you had. And so, and some of it would go to the warriors. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is very basic, but the point is that bureaucracy was tied to the medium, and the medium, I mean, be it paper, papyrus, or in Mesopotamia, clay, you know, it's something you go to an office or to a scribe and you say, okay, here's my paper. And then he will like look at it, and then he will, you know, send it to the next office or to another, you know, something else, to an agency. Someone will get now and say the more modern world, you get a piece of paper and you look at it, you go to a file cabinet, you open up and see, you compare, yes, put a stamp on it. It's one step after another. That's mm-hmm. And that is the way that basically operation of the public sector, also the private, but mm-hmm. I'm concerned about the public sector. The bureaucracy has worked since it was invented. Mm-hmm. In fact, it continued even the digital era because people would use PDFs for mm-hmm. exactly the same mm-hmm. thing. Mm-hmm. But what digitization allows, if you have the right architecture, and we do, mm-hmm. Is to turn it into a parallel process, mm-hmm. which means that all these things can be, all the bureaucratic processes can be completed simultaneously. Mm-hmm. So what does that mean? In a real life example, on the demand side, say with the citizen, mm-hmm. And the way it used to be here, this is told to me by the guy who designed this particular feature, but mm-hmm. In the 90s he had his first kid, and he said it was just crazy. It was winter, he had her go to the population registry, get an ID, be assigned an ID, go to the Bureau of Vital Statistics, get a birth certificate, with that go to the health insurance company to get health insurance for the kid, and then he had to run to his municipal government, because basically if you register the kid in the municipal government, then that means there's access to municipal government services and a right to go to the school and all that stuff, right? So he went around and said that. And he said, I don't ever want to do that again. So when we're designing the architecture overall, it's designed so that only the hospital or the doctor asks the mother or the family, what's the kid's name? And then that is then sent to the population registry. Mm-hmm. From there, I mean, having been assigned a number, an ID number, everyone else is informed. The Bureau of Vital Statistics gets this and issues the paper birth certificate for the rest of the world, this outside Estonia. And the health insurance company says, okay, we have a new person and is now entitled to health insurance. And the municipal government gets a notification. There's an additional citizen now living in your town, and you have these obligations. And also you get a little more money because part of the support for the mm-hmm. municipal government comes from how many people live there. So I mean, that's an example of a parallel process on the demand side. On the supply side, works kind of the same way. I mean, if you open a business, you have to register all of the owners and the members of the board. But of course, those people have to go through a check to make sure they've paid their taxes and they have, you know, they don't have any outstanding crimes and all this. And instead of having this process going sort of serially from one office to another, you know, being checked by you know, the tax bureau and by the police, all that is sent out automatically and it's checked digitally and the answer comes back in a matter of minutes, as opposed to up to, well, remember when we started this, it took a year and a half to open a business in Italy. They've sped up the process somewhat, but in any case, you know, 15 minutes versus a year and a half. Now, if you think about the way the government works, if you put it on a, or public services work, if it's in, if processes are parallel, they become a far more efficient. And you can do all kinds of interesting things with that. You can apply AI to things that, for example, I mean, really at the most primitive level, your driver's license will expire in 3 months. Have you, you know, you need to go do this or that, which you can all do digitally. And then a little more complex, saying, well, here's something you have not used, but you can use this. I mean, all kinds of services can be improved with parallel processing combined with AI, looking across databases to see if there are things that can be done. But this also allows you to get rid of a lot of bureaucracy, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, because it's not done on paper, so you can actually shrink the bureaucracy. And because it becomes more efficient, you save money. Mm-hmm. Another aspect of this is that, now this is, if it doesn't make sense, I'll explain it. But basically, by making non-discretionary decisions, mm-hmm. strictly database decisions, mm-hmm. Digitized, as opposed to the way most governments in the world work, where you go to a bureaucrat, mm-hmm. and you apply for something. Now, something you're owed or deserve to get. So you get a certain amount of, say, support for having two kids. Now, in the old days, in Estonia and everywhere else, in most places in the world, well, you would go and do that, and you'd hand in a paper, and then it would be checked and checked and checked. Mm-hmm. But on top of that, the bureaucrat in very many countries would take some money for it. Mm-hmm. I mean, the problem of this called petty corruption. Mm-hmm. Grand corruption is when you bribe a minister mm-hmm. to give you a contract, but petty corruption is the day-to-day sort of massive corruption in some societies, where the bureaucracy earns its money from little bribes, and in fact, it allows some countries to actually they build that into their budgetary process. They pay their civil servants very little, knowing that they will supplement their income from bribes. Mm-hmm. I explained this to a journalist in Greece. And she said, oh, fucky lucky. And I said, huh? She goes, that means little envelope mm-hmm. in Greek. Mm-hmm. So that if you want to get a service that you're entitled to from someone in the bureaucracy, you always have to bring a little envelope. A little envelope obviously has a little bit of cash mm-hmm. to get things moving. We've eliminated that. In fact, Estonia is now one of the least corrupt countries anywhere. And not only, I mean, we used to say we're the least corrupt post-communist country, but that doesn't really mean much when you're less corrupt than most of the European Union. So that's, I mean, these are the kind of benefits that accrue from digitizing public services. Mm-hmm. And I think that basically, digitization, of course, changes society's, relative position in the world. More digitized societies are more efficient and offer better services, be it just, already in terms of healthcare. But I mean, they because of the efficiencies, they also grow faster. I've come to the conclusion that the next 30 years, or I'll put it differently, that if the big worldwide task of the second half of the 20th century was building transport infrastructure, railroads, ports, big highways, to get commerce moving, then the big task facing Western societies, or all societies, frankly, actually, is the digitization of public services to make them more efficient. And it is not at all a given that the countries that did the best in the 20th century will do the best in this realm. I was at Stanford for almost 4 years after my term ended. And I had to register my daughter to go to school. In order to do that, I had to first take my electricity bill, which proved that I lived there, mm-hmm. drive to the municipal school board office, mm-hmm. pick a number, wait in line wait in the waiting room for 20 minutes. And I had to take with me my electricity bill, my passport, which included my visa, the kids' documents, and also something called a DS-2019 form, which said that I'm working employed by Stanford. Mm-hmm. So I gave all this paperwork to the person I was sitting there with behind her desk. She took it and went and made photocopies of everything, and then came back and then proceeded to write out all of the relevant data, whatever it was that she thought was relevant, but she copied this out. So this whole process took like 2 hours, or maybe an hour and a half, all to register my daughter to go to school. Now, Estonia, that doesn't even happen, because you're already, you go to your local school, just as I went to my local school, but I don't have to prove anything to anybody because the kid is already so you can think of the efficiencies or inefficiencies. Mm-hmm. Now, if you think of that happening across the United States, everywhere, that's how it's done. Even if it's, and especially it's even done in Palo Alto, mm-hmm. the center of the IT world, where in a 12-kilometer radius you have the headquarters of Tesla, Apple, Google, Facebook, Palantir, YouTube, they're all there. Mm-hmm. All of the innovation that's come out of there. Yet when it comes to public services, it is a complete and utter disaster. Well, disaster may be far too much, but it is no different from the way public services were run in the 1950s, with the possible, at least in this whole process, the only exception is that in the 1950s, they did not have photocopying machines to make a copy of my documents. Now they do. Other than that, it's just like the 1950s. And again, if that's what it's like in the center of IT innovation, what the hell is it like in the rest of the world? So if you think of that
happening, I mean, that gives my little country a huge advantage compared to the United States, already in terms just of trees cut down and people spent doing mindless bureaucratic tasks that could be far better done digitally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, your visit in 2018 had a great impact in the Taiwanese political discourse about these issues. And in addition to the e-residency, which directly inspired the Taiwan Gold Card, your speech about only marriage, divorce, and land acquisition requires personal showing up to a desk. That also left a lasting impact. And I think we're actually
we're working on the land acquisition too.
You did?
We've updated the land acquisition or transfer has uh-huh. been changed here. So you don't, I mean, you have to go through an additional verification mm-hmm. process, but you can do that digitally online.
Okay, great.
You just have to do it in real time. Mm-hmm, so mm-hmm. you don't, I mean, yep. you identify yourself in mm-hmm. real time and mm-hmm. then all of your other documentation works. So you don't have to show up.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Right. So Taiwan is well on that path. Actually, just today, which is May of the 30th of May, where we made this recording, we just digitalized this entire process of home quarantine, isolation, credential for getting the insurances and so on, which were paper based. Now, it was not subject to petty bribery, but it's subject to this ideas of like everyone want to get it as soon as possible so that the bureaucrats in the municipalities were simply overwhelmed by the numbers. So sometimes it takes this kind of stress testing moment for digitalization to happen. I was in a panel, I think a couple of weeks ago, with the CIO of Estonia, also Mr. Ilves, and we
He's
talked.
My about, son.
It's your son. Okay, we're going to spend 4 days, I think, next week in Italy together with other CIOs of the world. Right. So I think the topic was about proactive services because, as you correctly pointed out. Of course, there's no petty bribes anymore, and the city councillors or legislators cannot have a comparative advantage in getting first in the queue because it's fairly moderated by that algorithm and so on. But you also mentioned about the automatic reminder of renewal of driver's license. Now, that sounds very harmless, but there's all other kinds of, especially around social welfare and social security, and also about caring for people in vulnerable positions and so on, where it may not be the norm for that person to be diagnosed by a automated algorithm and get notification about it. Do you have an kind of inkling of feeling about how the norms around proactive services should be discussed and set?
Well, I mean, they are all about public records. Mm-hmm. So they're not, I mean, the privacy issue doesn't really come
no,
up.
No, it's
the
not public about record, privacy. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
yeah. I mean, you can choose to or not. I mean, you can ignore it or you can do something okay. about it.
Okay.
So if I'm told, as I was told in my, last year, my digital identity needed to be updated. Mm-hmm. Well, I probably would not have done that until I discovered one day that my ID was not working, unless I'd been reminded. Because I don't go around looking at it saying, oh, it's. I've already experienced once my driver's license running out. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I don't want to go through that again. It was such a pain.
Okay.
So I'm very happy that I'm told that my driver's license will expire in 6 months, and I should now undertake renewing it. Mm-hmm. And that's what you do. I don't know. I had a more interesting case recently. Is that because my younger son is underage? He's registered to live both in Latvia and in Estonia. Oh.
And because he spent most of his time here, but he's also lives in Estonia. And so I got a letter from the social welfare agency. Well, first I get a letter saying, you have a letter, do you want to open it? And then you have to do it through authentication. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yep. So no one else can open it. Mm-hmm. And then it said, well, we noticed that your son is registered in two European Union countries. And he is receiving the kind of like everyone gets like some little amount of money everywhere in Europe for like having a kid. It's not much, but we noticed that it's 32 euros in Latvia, in our country, mm-hmm. in Estonia, it's 60 euros. Mm-hmm. Would you like us to give you the difference?
Oh, wow. That's proactive.
That's quite proactive. Mm-hmm. I would say, what the hell? It's a service looking for things to assist people with, which I kind of find mm-hmm. One of the benefits. I mean, if you put yourself into a paper world, no one would ever know unless I actually said, oh, well, what's the law on this? What's the law on that? Here I get this, there I get that. I mean, mm-hmm. then go and file a paper to ask for it. And, I mean, it's so this is where that's the direction we're trying to move into, is to make more and more services proactive the idea ultimately would be government as a service mm-hmm. rather mm-hmm. than as an obligation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Right. So the idea is that if it's assistive, right, if it respects the ultimately the choice and dignity of the person that, well, like right. all assistive technologies must honor, then you think it's a right. net win. It's a good idea. I happen to agree too.
We haven't had any opposition to it so far. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's the conversation we need to have, because there's, as your kind of instinctual response that it's not about privacy shows, in many EU countries, the conversation becomes although it's a publicly available record, I have not authenticated to be aggregated in this way, kind of semi-privacy-like conversation. I remember visiting France right before I became digital minister in 2016, and I also met a Estonian kind of small delegation talking about X-Road and other innovations in the Senate. I think the response was about whether this is too open, not just to bureaucrats, but rather to the entire communities of people possibly offering those services. I mean, the government contractors and IT vendors and things like that, which doesn't seem to be a social kind of controversy in Estonia. Would you like to elaborate a little bit about this kind of different norm?
Well, I'll give you an example this is where cultural norms come in. Mm-hmm. In my country, all property records are public. Mm-hmm. When I mentioned this in Greece, mm-hmm. I said, what? Okay. What? Mm-hmm. And again, my country does not publish people's income mm-hmm. taxes. But Finland and Sweden every year publish everybody's income taxes. Mm-hmm. So people go and look and see how much income tax did so-and-so pay, right? So, I mean, these are cultural norms. And in Greece, the idea of having a public record of what you own is completely bizarre and in many ways probably completely unacceptable, whereas in our case now the other thing what this actually ties to is what gives sort of assists in preventing abuse mm-hmm. is that we have mutual reciprocal transparency. So as you can imagine, when I was in office, there was always, I mean, there was real, there's regular interest in what politicians own. And what property do they have? Mm-hmm. Has he bought anything? So, I mean, that, so what I own or property there is public, is public. The public record is there. You can go look at it. But I can also see who went looking for it. So, mm-hmm. you know, one of the yellow journalists whose regular beat is to go and make sure that, you know, who's bought something and then write a story about it. I mean, I, since I never bought anything, I didn't have to worry, but I did see that, you know, certain journalists, identifiable journalists, were looking at my records. And, oh, I saw them. I said, oh, so you're sniffing around my records. How do you know? What is this? This is the secret police. They go, no, this is public. If it works both ways, you can see my records. I can see who's looking at me. And they were like, oh.
Mm.
It's a mutually accountable ledger. Yeah.
Right. So it's, I mean, it, mm. but as I said, it is a cultural matter. And it tends to sort of follow latitude. The more northern you are in Europe, the more transparent you are. And the more southern, the more, the less transparent you are. So that's, but those, I mean, that's, those are the kind of things you can do with, if you, when you digitize.
Right. So what I'm hearing is that social norms plays a big part in what community ledgers are considered transparent or public and which community ledgers are considered private or not public. Do you see that in Europe as part of this wave of digitalization, different cultures adapting their norms for the new possibilities of becoming transparent and public, or do you see that is the technologies working to adapt to social norms, but with those norms pretty inflexible as it is?
You know, basically the whole issue of what it is, I mean, it's a political decision what you end up allowing people to see or not see. And of course, political decisions are based on cultural norms. And so as I mean, if you look across Europe, I mean, in Northern Europe, we're very transparent. Southern Europe, we're less trans, people are less transparent. Property records are open for public inspection in digitally in Estonia. They, when I mentioned this in Greece, the people were aghast that anyone could possibly see what you, what property you own. Well, I mean, the hope is that things become more open since increased transparency has all kinds of beneficial effects. Mm-hmm. It works, however, also with in Mike in Estonia's case, that we have reciprocal transparency so that people can look at my property records, but I can see who's looking at them. Mm-hmm. Which of course makes makes it all a little more responsible than otherwise. Whether it moves in that direction is hard to say. I mean, the other problem is that countries, the further south you go, you also find that they're less transparent. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's a hope, but mm-hmm. it takes a long time.
Mm-hmm. It's a possibility. My last question is about innovation. The panel in which that I met your son and also your successor, the next president after you, was about startups. It seems Estonia is very big on startups, from Skype to Wise.com, lots of unicorns. Some of the world's leading innovation and solutions came there. So what was your advice or message to younger generations outside of Estonia who want to learn about how to apply the spirit of innovation to play a bigger role in the global struggle to advance democracy and protect our free and open societies?
Well, the most basic is learn to code. I mean, So you know what you're talking about when you're when you are talking about this. And I think there's a huge, there's a greater and greater gap between people who understand tech and people who don't. C.P. Snow is a literary novelist who wrote, who gave us the term the corridors of power, actually, but he was also a physical chemist. And so he wrote an essay in 1959 called The Two Cultures about how he, as a physical chemist, could sit at one table at Cambridge University, where he was, and discuss, you know, quantum mechanics, I assume. And then he could walk over and drink wine with the poets, novelists, and Shakespeare scholars. He said he was the only one who could walk between those tables. And that was back when technology was actually, it didn't really play a major role in everyday life. And I remember reading 1984, a long time ago, but saying, what do you mean? How can a television look at you? Well, here we are.
Here we are.
I mean, it may not be a TV. It's just your computer screen that is also capable of looking at you. And we have enough cases of hacking that where you don't even know you're being looked at. Technology is has moved so much in everyday life. I mean, in the 1950s, no one, you thought if you left your house, you were far away from your phone. No one knew where you were. Today, because you have a mobile phone, everyone sees where you are. I mean, not everyone, but you, people can see where you are. This has left a huge gap in policymaking between those who are policymakers and legislators, who in general are like the poets and novelists in C.P. Snow's essay. They have no clue how technology works, and also come up with a lot of misguided ideas about what to do with technology. And then on the other hand, you have the geeks, who I would say in some cases, to put it mildly, are somewhat ethically challenged. And do not really think about the ethical implications of what they're doing. Nor, I mean, even if they do think about it, you take the case of the Equifax hack in the United States, where they just didn't pay enough attention to cybersecurity, and as a result, the financial records of 150 million Americans were made were stolen. They weren't made public. So what we need to do is bring together policymakers, lawmakers, and people who do the tech to be more on, if not on the same page, at least on the same chapter. Because we're not, we see this divergence between technology and the sort of in the democratic world, an understanding of technology on the people who decide how it can be used legally. And that leads to all kinds of problems I have seen over the years, and which I kind of wish we would pay more attention to this. So my solution to this is not, it's nothing, it's no major brainwave, but I mean, certainly I would suggest all people who want to get into policy to learn a little bit about how technology works, more than just being able to use Word and Twitter and Facebook. And at the same time, this is the harder task, but really drill down on tech companies, saying, look, people, you have to, we're gonna hold you responsible for screw ups in a much bigger way than we have. You have to pay attention to these ethical issues, which they have not, frankly, and we know they have not.
Excellent. So joining in the same chapter, the politicians, the imagineers, the people who walk across different cultures. President Ilves, thank you for joining today. And for our audience, please check more information and videos on TaiwanPlus.com. Also, we have a YouTube channel, so if you like today's episode, be sure to subscribe and share. See you next time. Live long and prosper.